Have any of you been to the Meadows Museum? Oh, great. Well, it's a jewel of a museum. It is the most comprehensive collection of Spanish art outside of Spain. And we have been in the beautiful building located at the SMU campus since 2001. And to tell you the importance of the collection is by way of telling you that the King and Queen of Spain came to the dedication of this building and have generously seen to it that we get very important loans from Spain, as the example of El Greco that was just mentioned, and we will be talking about it later on. There are several exhibits at the museum going on at one time. The Pentecost painting by El Greco is the principal one, but we also have about 25 objects from the Birdwell Library, also located on the SMU campus, and most of them are these unbelievably beautiful books and manuscripts dating back to the 14th and 15th century. And they are everything from letters issued by two of the Spanish kings to collections of sermons and even a medical manual that was translated from Latin into Hebrew for a Jewish doctor in 1466. They are just beautiful. And then the third exhibit that we have going on are contemporary art pieces inspired by some of the most important works at the Prado Museum, and they're all done by living artists today. But today we're going to talk principally about the confluence of cultures that occurred in Spain, and specifically in Toledo, which was the city in which El Greco lived. There's a wonderful word in Spanish called convivencia, and it is a term that fits beautifully in this talk, for it is the ability of people to live together. And in this case, it was the coming together of Jews, Christians, and Muslims in the medieval Spain. And when I talk about Spain, at that time, Spain was not a country per se, but I'm talking about that Iberian Peninsula that today is Spain. To give you some brief background, first of all, Jewish people were in Spain 1,000 years before even the Romans arrived. The Romans were there for about 600 years until the Roman Empire collapsed. And the contributions that they left were Latin and Christianity, which they brought to Spain. Then the Visigoths came. They were an Aryan tribe that came into Spain and stayed for 2 centuries. And they were people who converted to Christianity once they had established in the peninsula. They were not people who mixed in. They never intermarried with other people in the country, and therefore always remained a minority of population that was less than 5%. And one of the odd things was that when they first arrived, they were highly tolerant of the Jewish people in the peninsula. But once they converted to Christianity, they became very intolerant of Jews. They made their capital in Toledo, which became the most prosperous city in Spain, and also would be the most prosperous period for Toledo in all of its history. They had very wealthy nobility, It was said that they used only goblets and basins made of precious metals and wore garments of the superfine silk and had gems crusted everywhere. And the height of the richness in their material goods as well as their culture was in the 7th century. Letters and learning were cultivated in Toledo very highly. And also Toledo would become the base and a very important city for the powerful Catholic bishops. Then the Moors arrived, and they came on 711 and would stay until 1492. coincidentally the year that America was discovered. And these were people who brought Islam and the Arabic language with them. They didn't bring their women, and so they quickly became intermarried with the people from the Iberian Peninsula. They were not from Syrian descent, except for a handful. They were Islamic, but they were from North Africa. The Quran dictated that they pay respect to people of the book, people, that is, who believed in one God. And so therefore, Jews and Christians were treated with respect and protected under the rules of the Quran. So Christians and Jews felt free to continue to practice their faith, received almost the same rights as the Arabized Africans, but they were taxed at higher rates. So they might, at the early years, been some conversions for convenience sake, but they were never forced upon them. The Moors brought great contributions. And I wanted to show you this map to show you how the Islamic world looked from the 7th through the 10th centuries, the 10th century being the height of their influence and their culture in Spain. The Islamic movement started in the east and traveled through northern Africa. And as you can see, there's only a small body of water separating Africa from Spain that is about 10 miles wide. So it was not a difficult voyage to make it into Spain. And as you can see by the brown color, they controlled most of Spain and what today is Portugal. But this section up in the north, bordering with France, was never Moorish. And none of Spain was entirely Moorish or entirely Catholic during a 700-year period. Different fights for power ensued over the 700 years, and so certain cities would at times be under Moorish rule and at times under Christian rule. But the Moors who came brought numerous contributions to society and culture. Among them, in medicine, for instance, they introduced anesthetic. They were doing surgeries for cataracts, and they were even doing surgeries to relieve the pressure in the brain. So even Catholic nobility from the north would travel south to areas where the Moorish doctors could perform these surgeries. In mathematics, algebra was almost entirely an invention of the Moors, as was spherical trigonometry. And Arabic numbers replaced the clumsy Roman numerals that had been used. They were the first to use the decimal notation for numbers, and the concept of zero was an Arab contribution. They studied astronomy and had great observatories, and it is reported that they even had flush toilets in private bedrooms down in the south in Granada, in this area. So they were quite advanced. The rest of Europe in the 10th century was in a cultural darkness. But the Arab civilization outshone everything that could be found in Europe. Arabized Christians and Jews in the south of Spain all learned and were fluent in Arabic. This was the language of the country. All business was transacted in it. Even the minutes at Jewish synagogues were kept in Arabic. And young Christian Arabs would compose poetry, romantic poetry in the language. Some of the finest authors in Spain were Jewish people who worked in Arabic. And this was a period where Jews enjoyed tranquility for centuries in both the Muslim and the Christian parts of the kingdom, although they were being brutally persecuted in the rest of Europe. But an invasion of fanatical African tribes caused the Jews to flee to the north in 1147. But they were warmly received in the Christian north and were able to continue the good life that they had had in the south. This is one of the objects from the permanent collection at the Meadows. It's the oldest piece in the museum, and it is a capital, or that is to say, the top portion of a column that was in one of the palaces in southern Spain. And it is very typical of Islamic art in that it lacks any figures of animals or people, as that is against Islamic tradition. This plate looks very Arabized. It looks something that you'd find in the Middle East, you might think. But it is a piece of what is called Mudéjar art. Mudéjar is the term used for objects created by Moorish craftsmen for Christian use. Mudéjar art. And we know that it is not used for an Islamic use because the ancient writing along the perimeter, the edge of this plate, are the words of the first book of John. So we know that it is a Christian piece. Here is a modern map of Spain so that you can see where the city of Toledo is. It is centrally located, so it was a perfect place for the Visigoths to form their capital. And you can see that Madrid is just north of Toledo. And if you were to visit Spain today, you would most likely visit Madrid and make an hour and a half trip down to Toledo for the day and see the rich culture that is still left there today. The Visigoth capital of Toledo would be transformed into an important Catholic city and eventually be the capital of Catholic Spain until Philip II moved the capital to Madrid. This beautiful image is again from the permanent collection at the museum, and it is a painting by Joaquin Sorolla made in 1902, and it depicts Toledo. The title of it is The Blind Man of Toledo. And here you see the beautiful bridge of Alcantara, which is one of the main things you would see in Spain and in Toledo, and you would cross it yourself to enter from the newer part of Toledo to old Toledo. And here, in contrast, is a painting by El Greco, done almost 400 years before. And he takes a little artistic license in locating the buildings on the right, but you can recognize that the same bridge appears in this painting. And here we have a contemporary look at that bridge, which, as I said, will still carry you into the old city today. In Toledo, it was said that Arabian historians had need of all their power of hyperbole to overestimate the richness of the Toledo treasure. It was just such a beautiful city. And wandering scholars from all over Europe came to Toledo to see and to learn. And their libraries and translation areas were highly regarded. Jewish settlers in this area that had fled the south became some of the most important people for us today because the classic Greek literature and philosophy had been entirely lost after the fall of the Roman Empire. And these Jewish savants were the only ones that could translate the Arabic versions of those pieces of fine literature and bring them back into Latin and Spanish. And from here, they were carried back to the rest of Europe. Toledo was one of the strongholds for Jewish people in Europe and a center of Hebrew culture and activity. Here are some of the buildings that still exist in Toledo today. This looks somewhat Muslim and Moorish in the window design and the ancient lettering, but we know that it's a Christian temple because the figure of man is used in the decorations, and that would have never occurred in a mosque. It was against the traditions. But the architecture style of the Moors was so firmly established that you would see it in most of Spain and can still see it today. When Alfonso VI, a Catholic king, entered Toledo in 1085, he turned it into a Christian city, but he gave the Moors the same rights and privileges that the Moors had given Christians 370 years before when they first entered the country, and that is that people could retain their religion and their properties. But his entering the city did end Moorish control of Toledo, and it became part of Christian Spain. Here is a synagogue that was later turned into a church, but today it is neither. It is a monument to that history of the city. And you can again see that even in a Jewish synagogue, we see all the characteristics of this Moorish architecture. In the mid-14th century, Spain had a king whose name was aptly Peter the Cruel. And he surrounded himself by Jewish financial advisors and established Jewish men as the tax collectors. And he only used Muslims in his personal guards. It's odd that he wouldn't trust any Catholics around him and surrounded himself with other people. But it led to an unfortunate circumstance, and that is that Jews became regarded as instruments of this king's cruelty, and therefore anti-Semitism began to grow amongst the nobles and the clergy. And in 1391, riots in the south of Spain would cause the death of thousands of Jews, and tens of thousands of Jews were forced to accept conversion to Christianity. Here is a mosque that is still in Toledo today, and it is the only one that remains relatively unchanged and was not torn down. And here is a palace in the outskirts, and it's again in that Mudéjar style in its interior and also in these windows. And this church, the Monasterio, is a beautiful church using very European influences in its interior. But if you look at that ceiling, it is entirely the influence of the Moors. And it has the Lion of Castile at its center, but it definitely remains a Mudéjar object. When the Jewish people began to be tolerated, many converted to Christianity and had intermarriage with older Christian families. So you would soon see that between Moorish intermarriages and Jewish intermarriages, most families had some of that blood in their family tree. But there would become a period in which that would be denied by most people. But it definitely was something that was true at the time. And as more and more intolerance came to be, the Inquisition was established in 1480 in Toledo. This was partly with the influence of the Roman Catholic Pope and the bishops in Toledo. It is said that probably envy of the wealth and influence of Jews and Jewish converts led to the Inquisition, and that it was more of a political move, as it deprived suspected false converts of their land, their wealth, and their influence. And it provided a religious and emotional unity for Catholic Spain. Here we have a tower of the Church of Santo Tomé, which was originally a tower used by the Moors for calls to prayer, but the top portion for the bell tower was added in Christian times. And here again, we have the beautiful walls of the synagogue and the interior walls of the synagogue, again in Mudéjar style. One of the gates has every style in it, one of the gates of the city. And finally, we come to an El Greco portrait. I do want to finish one note about the Jews in this area and the Moors before I move on. And that is to say that the final surrender of the Moors occurred on January 2nd of 1492, when the last Islamic ruler in southern Spain handed the keys to his palace to Ferdinand and Isabella, the Catholic kings. They were initially guaranteed religious freedom and allowed to retain their property, but years later, they would lose that and eventually be massacred. 3 months after that final surrender, Jews were given 4 months to leave Spain. 15 centuries they had lived in Spain, and it is reported that 150,000 Jews had to leave the country. Today, there's only 3,000 to 4,000 Jewish people in all of Spain. They never came back. Imagine if we went tomorrow to Louisiana and said everyone of French descent of any sort must leave the country. And one of the other rules was you couldn't leave with any gold, silver, or precious jewels. So even if you were able to sell your properties, you couldn't leave with your wealth. So it was a very sad ending to the convivencia and the richness of those cultures that had coexisted so peacefully, both under Moorish rules and under some of the Catholic rules. The Toledo that El Greco came to was a greatly changed city. Philip II, the Spanish monarch, had moved the capital of Toledo from Toledo to Madrid in 1561. So that would be a detrimental and almost the end of the richness that Toledo had ever enjoyed. But El Greco, who was born Domenico Theotokopoulos and was born in Crete, traveled via Italy and arrived in Spain in 1577 at the age of 36. And he established himself in Toledo, a society of aristocratic, homogeneous, God-fearing, militaristic men, and one of the most Catholic cities in all of Europe, certainly the most Catholic city of Spain. They were living under the strict Counter-Reformation rules of the Council of Trent and Philip II. Men all seemed to dress alike in dark clothing with dazzling white pleated ruffled collars, and they all, you will see, appear to have the same goatee and haircut. But this pleased El Greco, because he said this was human architecture reduced to its essentials, with nothing about it to deflect an eye intent on penetrating the soul. He enjoyed painting their portraits and would even include them in his religious works. Here is this lovely self-portrait. And here is one of the first commissions that were of important commissions that he received in Toledo. And that was for this painting, The Spoliation of Christ, which was to be in the main sacristy, and it still remains there today. Now, this painting didn't come without controversy, because El Greco place Christ at a lower level in the painting than other men. And at that time, paintings never, if they depicted Christ, Christ was at the highest point of a painting, and no other man would be above him. So that was a bit of controversy. And the second bit of controversy was that at the time when you were given a commission for art, you were never, the price was never established until after it was completed and it was in the hands of the church. And then they would decide how much you should be paid for it. And they were supposed to have two independent people help them with that price. El Greco was used to Italy, where artists were more highly regarded, and he had a pretty good ego about his self-worth. So they could never agree on the price, and he took them to court. This would not be the last time he sued a patron in Toledo, but it would be the last time that he received a commission from the cathedral. However, that didn't seem to deter the rest of his clientele. Then most great artists in this period sought to be a portraitist or an artist for the royal family, because that would mean not only great fame, but also a monthly stipend. So there was an introduction made to the court of Philip II, and he commissioned El Greco to paint the Martyrdom of St. Maurice, and it was to go into the king's private chapel. When it was delivered, the king paid for it, but refused to ever hang it. And it changed hands several times, and it wouldn't be until Velázquez, under Philip IV, purchased it back for one of the palaces of Philip IV, that it would come back to belong to the royal family. It was totally against anything that the king expected to see in art, both in its style and in the way that he had portrayed what was important, because what is important here is the martyrdom of St. Maurice and all of his soldiers. And here it is cast to the side. And that just wasn't to the liking of neither the church nor the king, who was very pious. But here El Greco thought he was doing a great thing for the king that he would like, because the faces of the people in the forefront are generals of Philip II's. But that was not to be. And here on the right, you can see the painting that was commissioned from an Italian artist to go into the place where this painting should have gone. It is the same subject, but as you can see, the martyrdom appears front and center and becomes the focal point of the work. So again, El Greco returns to Toledo, never to receive another royal commission, but it would not hamper him being very successful. This was one of the very first churches he worked in, and as you would see the altarpiece today, this is a church that commissioned him to do the principal two panels. But sadly, the two panels, which I have made a larger copy for you on the right, are now located, one at the Chicago Institute of Art and the other at the Prado Museum. Because when Joseph Bonaparte had the crown in Spain, he ordered all monasteries and convents closed, and many of the works were taken out of altarpieces and either not brought back, or the convents and monasteries later would not have the funds and would sell these because they needed the money. So the ones in the altarpiece are only copies. Here is one of the people that had his portrait made by El Greco. And it is, I think, a beautiful portrait, because there's something so melancholy about the face of this man. And I think it speaks to the fact that this man had been ill and lost his hearing. And so he was deaf, and his whole world had become a very closed world. And I think he has really caught that. He knew this man well. They both were men of letters who enjoyed literary and philosophical discussions, and so they knew each other well. Here is a portrait that he made of the cardinal that lived in Toledo. It would have been a very important commission. And it is, two elements of it are extraordinary, and that are the hands, which Unamuno, one of the Spanish writers, called winged hands, hands that reveal far more than words can reveal, and faces that he portrays full of anxiety, resignation, or melancholy. It is said that one of the essential features of an El Greco portrait is the intensity of the expression. And here we have a few others. And as you can see, there's no ornamentation, nothing in the background. Everything is about the sitter. Those beautiful hands and those beautiful, intense looks of these men and the severity in which they dress. I'd like to point out that the one on the far side, this is an image of a painting that is at the Kimball Museum, one of my favorites there because of that beautiful hand. But this is the most well-known work of El Greco. It was painted for the Church of Santo Tomé in Toledo, and it was a commission that sought to pay homage to the Count Orgaz, who had died a generation or two before this painting was commissioned. Count Orgaz had been a very devout Catholic and a great patron of the church, of this particular church, so they sought to honor him with this painting. And all the commission said was that they sought to honor this man. And it was El Greco's genius that devised this painting to honor the time of his death. It's painted in two planes with two very different styles. There's a lot of realism in the lower portion, and the other is so spiritual, so heavenly, and so lightly painted. Now, the lower portion contains the figure of El Greco's own son, who is pointing, and that was used in a lot of religious paintings to denote, here, look, a lesson is about to be taught. And the lesson here is that the Count Orgaz, whose body is being carried, is such a devout man that two saints have come down from heaven to carry his body into his tomb. He is surrounded by men that are contemporaries of El Greco's, men he knew, and El Greco himself is right there. So he kind of included all of society of Toledo in the painting. I think of particular note is this beautiful white vestment of the priest. And we have a Franciscan priest on this side. Now, there are elements in this painting that cause you to look upward. And that is the intent of the artist, because as this man's spirit is being carried by an angel to heaven in the form of a baby, in heaven are waiting Saint Peter and Mary, and they are there to intercede in his behalf so that he can enter the heavenly gates and see God in the heavens. So the painting is full of symbolism. It is typical of him to crowd so many figures into a space and to have a space that always is moving upward rather than into a third dimension. And that is the richness of this painting. It was immediately popular, and today lines still form. He would include the nobility of Toledo in more paintings, including the Madonna of Charity here with sheltering the nobles with her mantle. Here is something else that he did that was ingenious, and that was that he decided to portray the apostles as portraits, as if they were living people. And he did several series for different churches because it became something fairly popular after they saw the first series. These six are part, only part of what would have originally been the 12, and all of these are at the Prado Museum in Madrid. And you can see the intensity of the look in these people's eyes, and the brilliant colors that are used by El Greco are very unique to him. You cannot say he's a particular style because he is just himself, very different from anyone else. And this is a work that is part of the museum's collection, and it is St. Francis in Meditation. It was a subject that he would paint frequently because it was popular, and as a good businessman, this sold very well. This little piece of paper at the bottom would have had the signature of Domenico Theotokopoulos. El Greco always signed his full Greek name. But due to a bad restoration or cleaning sometime before it was acquired by the museum, we can no longer see that signature. But there is a copy of this that I have seen in a museum in Bilbao where the signature was very, very clear. So this was a subject that we think he painted at least 20 times, almost identically, because it sold so well. And here is the main subject of the exhibit right now in the museum, and that is this painting that was loaned to us by the Prado Museum that was part of an entire altarpiece that was taken apart. Again, I think because of the Bonaparte's closing of churches and convents, and this had been in one of those and would never return. We know that there's at least six pieces. There might have been one more, but we know of these six because five are at the Prado Museum today, and one is in Bulgaria. And we don't know, I don't know how that got there. They depict the life of Christ, starting with the Annunciation, the baptism of Christ, the crucifixion, the ascension into heaven, and the piece that is at the museum right now, which is the Pentecost. The Pentecost is celebrated 50 days after the burial of Christ. And the scripture says that the Holy Spirit, here depicted as the dove at the top, appears to the apostles and fills them with tongues. And that is not the connotation that we have for it today. That is an ability to speak all languages so they could travel the world and preach. And there is some argument as to why he includes all three Marys in the composition, but it is a wonderful painting. It was intended to be hung higher than it is at the museum, or that you would see it from if you were standing on this stage. Everything in it is supposed to move you as the viewer in an upward direction. For you are viewing it at a lower level, so you are looking up. And the first two, the front two disciples, are looking upward as well. Everything, the faces, are all looking up at the Spirit. It was a wonderful symmetry and a wonderful composition. Again, with disregard of a third plane, everything is to move upward. And again, the unusual choice of colors that his contemporaries were not using. So he was a man entirely unique. Now, this work is the El Greco is hanging in the same room with this work, which is part of the permanent collection, and there's a big contrast to be had here. The faces in all of El Greco's people are all unique and lifelike in their expression, whereas the women here seem to all be made out of one same rather pasty mold. Only the Virgin and the saint, San Ildefonso, are the only ones that appear to be realistic. And you can see the difference in this artist strives to give us that third plane both here and in the depth of this archway, whereas El Greco seeks purposely to ignore that. So I think the El Greco really shows well when you contrast it with his contemporaries. There were other artists that would be influenced by him. Shortly after El Greco's death, he sort of disappeared from the radar. He was largely unknown for many years by most people in art, in the art world, ceased to be of any inspiration until the Impressionists came, who were fascinated with him. And so we have examples like Cezanne's bathers and Gauguin, who admired his use of color so greatly, and Van Gogh, who also wanted movement in his paintings, as had El Greco, and who also disregarded the third plane and realism. And here we have his biggest admirer of all, because look at the painting by El Greco, and look at the similarity and the inspiration that he gives Picasso for the painting that broke the mold and established cubism and abstraction in Les Demoiselles d'Avignon almost 400 years later. And I just think that's wonderful. And then these two works, this is a portrait of El Greco's son, who also, by the way, was a painter. And then the homage that Picasso is paying to the artist by painting the same work but in his own contemporary modern style. So I think that this work says a lot about how El Greco felt. And finally, I want to leave you with this that I found in a book about Toledo that was published in 1902. And here the man pays homage to the bridge that we had seen before, the Bridge of Alcantara. And he says, "A noble bridge this of Alcantara, old as the city, the work of all of Toledo's rulers, like Toledo, grim, stern, rude, destined it was seen to endure forever. Romans, Visigoths, Moors, and Castilians have lingered on it, triumphed on it, fled across it, and thought upon it. And across it today must walk every traveler entering with reverence this great temple of the medieval and the bygone." Thank you.